looking at the year three review of the 10-year contract with Capita for the customer support group, which covers back office type stuff such as human relations and estates and payroll, but also covers the interface with the public. Does not cover the other contract with Capita, the joint venture with the council called REAN, which covers highways and planning and regulatory matters like building regulations. I'm Councillor Jeff Cook. I'm a member of the Council's Performance and Contract Management Committee, and I'm one of the two Labour nominees on the working party. My right, Councillor Cathy Levine, is the second Labour nominee to that working party. On my left, Councillor Phil Cohen is chair and convener of a Labour Party working group looking at alternatives to outsourcing. I have a list of people who have said they want to present evidence to us. And I will start with John Dix, who is a well-known local blogger and takes a very keen interest in these matters.
And it's being recorded.
And yeah, it's been recorded here, and it will be transcribed. And I'm grateful to the Labour Group political assistant Gabby Kagan for setting all of this up, and we'll be doing the transcribing work.
Do you want to face that way or this way or?
There's some filming going on, so.
Yeah. I'm with that way. Better now.
Okay. It's a tricky one, this, because it's difficult to know where to start. It's such a big subject. And first of all, I thought, should I just come along and spear out all the stuff that you guys have heard at every committee meeting that I go to, and actually that really doesn't solve the issue here. So what I thought I'd do is I'd look at this around three key headings. One's around performance, so how well are they performing, what's the cost, and what commitments did they give at the outset of the contract, and actually are they living up to those commitments? So if I start with performance, how well are Capita performing? Well, there's a lot of data out there, and part of my concern is actually, as councillors on the committee, you're overwhelmed with data. And actually, I think that's the strategy, is drown you in paper so that actually you can't see the wood from the trees. And that's pretty awful. There is some raw data which they publish. They only publish it when I ask for it. And when I don't ask for it, they don't publish it. So for example, for the last contract performance for monitoring meeting, I couldn't attend. So they did publish that supporting data, and I haven't done yet. But actually, it generates an awful lot of raw data, which starts to reveal how badly they are performing in certain areas. There's telephony targets, for example, about how quickly they will answer calls and how many will be resolved. But they've got something called a virtual assistant, so that's when the phone is answered automatically. And actually, that then skews the data to make it look as if they're performing much better than they are. But when you look at areas like adult social care, council tax, and housing benefit, actually they're performing really badly if you look at the raw data. Now I asked for that raw data and it's quite revealing. I've got a handout for you if you'd like it. So that's Are You Being Shortchanged? And that starts to look at the number of calls that are just not even answered. Abandoned calls, you know, there are over 1,000 abandoned calls for things like council tax inquiries.
Mostly from me.
So, but that's not information you, as a committee, are given. You can only find that if you dig it out.
Are there performance targets? Sorry to interrupt you.
There are performance targets at a high level, but it comes back to this issue of there are overall targets for answering the phone. Because they've got this virtual assistant that they call, which automatically, you know, you talk to the phone, it's not somebody answering, it's an automated thing. All of those automatically score 100% because they're all answered straight away. They may not resolve your call, but as a result, it pulls the average of calls answered within the key performance indicator up. But as with any key performance indicator, it's not about looking at the bits that are doing really well. It's looking at the bits that are doing badly. And actually, it's the key people who really need services that are being let down most by the call centre. So if you've got a problem with your housing benefit, that becomes much more important. And if they're losing lots of calls there, that's a really big issue. There's face-to-face, they're measured on that. Now, they had lots of problems at Burroughs Oak Library and also at Barnet House. So the way they got around that problem is they said, well, we've introduced an appointment system. Now, that's good insofar as, okay, now you don't have to wait in a queue, but you might not get an appointment. So you can't drop in. It's taken away that ability to drop in if you've got a problem with your housing benefit. So it's a clever way around the problem, and it now means they can meet their key performance indicator. Emails and the web, the satisfaction on that's appallingly low, and they know it's low. My concern would be they've had millions to invest in the IT systems and the website, and they're still not hitting the targets. So it's just not good enough to say, well, people are unhappy with some of the policies. Well, no. And if you look at, again, at the detailed reports that come out for the performance contract monitoring meetings, you see that some of the areas where they're doing badly are areas that are actually controlled by Capita themselves. IT performance, I know it's not performing well and it's consistently not performed well. And I suppose there are lots of other things around performance, but one of the key questions is how do you measure performance? And what they keep doing is referring back to the start date of the contract. But we all know that at the very start of the contract, services have been run into the ground, and we were hugely dependent on a lot of temporary staff because so many people had left, knowing that Capita were going to take over. So actually, it's quite a false base. So it's actually about having absolute comparisons. Absolute performance targets, not just comparative ones. But like, take council tax collection. In the promises made at the outset, they said the baseline for council tax collection is 98.5%. They're not hitting that. But they're saying, but we're collecting more money. Well, yeah, that's because there are more homes on the council tax register. But actually, they're falling below the 98.5% baseline. So what have we gained? Nothing. So it's about looking at how we measure. I come on quickly now to costs. I don't want to go too much into this because it would take a long, long time. And what I would say is there were contract values that were put in the original business plan and that were subsequently put in the contract. Now, I've got the payment schedule from the contract which was published in October 2013. And what I've done is a comparison of what was contracted to be spent versus the spend to date. And if we just look at the CSG contract, setting aside the re-contract, they were contracted to pay, and that includes for the full year 2015-16, 87 million. what we've actually paid is 120.5 million, and we've still got 2 months to go of the year. So the difference is about 33.5 million quid, plus what we'll be billed in February and March. Now, the issue there is, well, what's that money being spent on? And actually, a lot of it's on things like special projects, gain share, things like that. So I'll just really quickly take you through a couple of examples on that. So special projects, there's a long list, and again, if you dive into the data, you can see it. Things like this, the sport and physical activity review, the waste depot relocation, library strategy. Now, all of those are paid at consultancy rates. So Capita get paid quite handsomely for some of these, and luckily, when the contract was originally published, they didn't redact the data very successfully. So I downloaded it, and it's subsequently been deleted, so you can't find it. But I have got the original list of contract rates. So for example, a project manager working on the libraries project is paid £978 a day, up to a director who's paid £1,390 a day, or a service director who's paid £1,400 a day. Now, it was interesting because at a recent committee meeting, I asked an officer, were some of these tasks being undertaken by Capita at consultancy rates that would have traditionally been undertaken by paid normal service staff? And the answer was yes.
Probably.
So what you are getting is, okay, we've got a cheap contract value, but everything extra is expensive, and you pay through the nose rate, and you pay consultancy rates. And to me, that's not very clever.
Okay.
Gain share. That's where Capita share in any savings they make. Now, some of those are real money spinners. The one that I go on and on about is the Conventura contract, which is the interim staff contract. Now, they have said that they have managed to renegotiate that contract. I have asked repeatedly for the evidence, and it's not been forthcoming. But I reckon they're going to claim nearly £1 million in total as gain share on that contract. And one of the reasons why they're doing so well out of it is because the contract is running out of control. So it's miles over budget. So they benefit from failure in managing that contract and those interim staff levels. There's a print room contract where they get all of the savings, 100% of the savings. And, you know, is it working in favour of small local companies? I don't think it is. Very briefly now, nearly at the end. Contract variations, that's a great one. So, as I've blogged about, Hugh Rayner quite rightly asked, before the contract was signed, that's how you make your money, isn't it? Contract variations. Well, yeah. And to date, those contract variations amount to £1.6 million. And there are a number of contract variations pending, so it could be significantly more. So it's a great way, and a lot of those have been initiated by Capita. The last point is about commitments, and what they promised versus what they delivered. Now, there's a schedule in the contract which sets out a whole load of commitments. What were they going to do? And I guess it's for somebody to sit down and go through and say, well, have you done them? So, for example, one of the things they said they were going to do is provide a community development fund that builds capacity and capability in the local ecosystem. For example, through providing mentoring, training courses and forums on winning and sustaining contracts with the Authority for Small and Medium-Sized Enterprises. Now, I don't know whether that has been done. I'm a small business in Barnet, and I've not seen any evidence of it. There are lots of others. There's 18 pages of commitments. Now, I don't know if anybody's actually gone back and revisited these to actually tick them off. But these form part of the contract. So, for example, they said they will implement a pilot to assess the value of Google services, social tools. I don't know whether they've done that. Service transfer date, implement a knowledge management cloud-based service to support transition. I don't know whether they've done that. There's lots of other ones, and some of them are quite important. I think they talked about an observatory, whatever that was.
Public health, not public health.
No, no, it was, I don't know what it was. It was some
knowledge centre, isn't it?
Yeah. But there are a pile here, and I suppose my question to you is, who's checking them? Because I get the impression that actually everybody worked like mad to get a contract signed, and then everybody's just left it in the past, and who's revisiting it? And is there a sufficient transparency for you as councillors to get officers to say, right, officers, you know, commitment T125, procurement management agent transformation, have they done this? Yes or no?
Are any of the is there any time limits attached to them?
Yeah, there are. 36 months, 24 months, 12 months. Yeah, there's. And again, some are certain and some are aspirational. But the point is that they're there. So that's it for me.
Well, I don't want to have this just as a sort of open-ended discussion, but we do have time for some questions and short discussion. I see that Keith has arrived, so he's our next contributor, and I understand that we need to be out of the room by 9, so want to keep a bit of structure on the discussion, so it's open to the floor now.
Me. I just wanted to ask John about the small business you were talking about, because I have actually asked about setting up a small business unit in Barnet, and I'm told that that's not appropriate. You know, we'd be interfering, and it's up to the local businesses to form their own structure. And whereas I think, as a council, we should be able to at least give the structure for local businesses to be able to have something. So I just wondered what it was you had there, because I hadn't seen it.
It's commitment T1-4 procurement, and it's got a time limit of within 12 months.
And it was for?
It's to provide a community development fund that builds capacity and capability in the local ecosystem through providing mentoring training courses, focuses on winning sustained contracts, and it's aimed specifically at SMEs and micro businesses up to a cap of 500,000.
I don't think that's been done. I have asked about that, and not specifically about that, what you're talking about having a small business unit, and I was told it wasn't going
to happen. There are a number of others which relate to small, but like there's 69 commitments in total. which are contractual commitments. These aren't woolly ones. These are actually included with it as an appendix to the contract.
I can just put in a comment here. I'm on the performance of contract management committee, which is supposed to be looking at all this sort of stuff. As John said earlier, we get drowned in performance data, but all of the contract management, such as it is done by officers, and practically nothing gets reported to the committee. And one of the things I've been pressing for is that we get less performance stuff, because that ought to go to the theme committees where people know about the detail, and that would leave more time for the committee to look at the contract management issues, such as the variations that were mentioned and the penalties that are applied for underperformance. And so that is an ongoing campaign, and the working party is now giving us an opportunity to focus on some of that stuff, and what John has just been telling us is very useful input to that. Theresa, you're next.
Yeah, I just like to ask John, do you think there's evidence, John, that Capita are actually concentrating on the areas where they do maximise their extra payments at, you know, at the expense of the core contract, the things that they're supposed to be providing but are very hard to monitor and measure?
I can't say for definite, because if I said that, I'd probably get sued. But
yeah,
what I would say is the evidence suggests that actually they do put a lot of focus on project work, because actually it's very, very lucrative and it's a way for them to earn significant money. And if they can pile a load of consultants on, you know, if you look at the value of those special projects, it's in excess of £10 million, and that's at consultancy fee rates. So it's very valuable to them.
Then, so on a period of a year, or?
Well, the contract's only been running for 2.5 years, and already, as I say, the difference between the contracted value and what we've paid is £33 million on the CSG contract. So some of that is for elements which have been specifically requested, but there are a lot of transformation projects being run. And I've looked at all the invoices, because I asked them as part of the inspection of the accounts, and actually they detail out those fee rates on those invoices.
It's not just about rates on projects, it's also about how many hours they invoice for. Because they are a monopoly supplier, they tell us, the council, how many hours, at which level of seniority is appropriate for each task. And so they've got the contract for 10 years, and thereafter they are the monopoly supplier. And so the way in which these things work is that you have not a loss leader, but a lower initial bid in the expectation of making the money on other things, as John has described. Yeah.
One other thing, when you talked about the contract variations, you said that they were initiated by Capita themselves.
Yes.
And are they approved by who? By the council or by officers?
By council officers.
Yes.
One of the issues which I've taken up is that under the council's constitution, there is an obligation for officers to report contract variations to the relevant committee. And allegedly because of an officer oversight, that didn't happen until I asked for it, and that was just at the last meeting. Now, they are now saying that some of these changes are trivial and that they don't need to be reported to councillors. At the last meeting we did get a list, but they were not described in any reasonable detail. Some of them were aggregated, and so this is ongoing work to tease out all of this stuff. But as I say, all the contract management has been done by officers, and the relevant committee has not been given the information to discuss. Anybody else?
Sorry, another question then. Obviously, all these contract variations, obviously they cost money. Do you have an upper limit on how much can be spent each year on all this, or is it completely open-ended?
Not every contract variation has a financial implication, but there are limits in the council constitution about what sums of money can be approved by officers. And so if it's working correctly, and I've no reason to think it doesn't in this respect, then if a change with a financial implication above that limit, which required either a senior officer or a committee to approve, then it would be reported. But it just hasn't happened in the 2.5 years so far. But I don't think they've ever come back and say we want to change the financial arrangements. Please approve it. What you will get is what are called delegated powers reports, where a senior officer approves a project spending, and that is published, at least the details, the commercially sensitive details might not be published, but the fact that it's happening is available on the website if you look for it.
Just a, you mentioned the telephony, which we get a lot of feedback from residents about not being able to get through an automatic system. So, but you said that that scores highly because it's they get it, they get received. Yeah. But what is there any measurement of when they are they put are the public connected to the person they want to be and the resolution of that?
There is a resolution. There absolutely, because actually the resolution on quite a lot of the calls that I highlighted is quite low. So I think, for example, on libraries there was some as low as 30% resolution.
That resolution means connecting with...
Or it means the problem was resolved. So, for example, one of the issues that we've had in the past is people will ring the main number, they will ask about a library issue, the person dealing with that will be unable to resolve it, and sometimes in the end they then direct them to the library. My argument would be, well, why didn't they just send them to the library in the first place?
Can I just add a sort of personal experience of trying to speak to the council by using the automated service? The first time I wanted to speak to governments about the rules for a petition, and I've now been told that actually by phoning Harrow, this is in writing, I've got the email, by phoning Harrow to speak to Barnet, I actually ended up doing the right thing. I phoned Harrow out of utter desperation because it was impossible. The kind of things that was happening was that the automated system was mishearing my words and putting me through to completely the wrong person. Or I felt that there was no way to get hold of a person. So the email I will send perhaps to John Dix or to whoever wants to look more, but it led me to have phone calls from Capita. I felt, although it's assigned by customer service, I felt like I was being accused and I was in the wrong the whole time. Finally, I've now had an apology just about. It's taken 4 or 5 months.
What's the reference to Harrow in order to speak to a lawyer?
Well, I'd read in the local paper that our legal department was run not by Barnet but by Harrow. Yes. So I phoned Harrow, who knew how to put me through to Barnet. And in my letter it says I did the right, that was the right thing to do.
Just as background, Barnet has outsourced its legal services to something called HB Public Law. The H stands for Harrow and the B stands for Barnet, and it's jointly owned by the two boroughs, but it's actually run by Harrow, and they also take on legal work from other local authorities. At one time Barnet had no lawyers at all, and you may remember the fiasco where after the annual meeting they set up committees wrong and some of the decisions were invalid. They now have a monitoring officer who is a qualified lawyer, but the day-to-day legal stuff is run out of Harrow. Theresa?
Yeah, just to say about making a complaint, I mean, I would urge people, please, if they do try and phone a department and it goes wrong, as it inevitably will, to make a complaint and then see what happens when you try to make a complaint, because you enter this Kafkaesque, labyrinthine hell of, you know, your complaint disappears, so then you have to make a complaint about your complaint, and then your complaint about a complaint is sent to someone else, and then it goes to Coventry, and you get... So, first of all, their web form, where you must complain about anything that's gone wrong. I've only used it twice, and twice my complaint has mysteriously disappeared. I suspect that's very common. So I don't think they're collating proper and accurate statistics on complaints, because it's so difficult to make one in the first place, and when you do, I think they get lost. And then you get sort of just most ridiculous responses saying, oh, well, 88% of people are satisfied with, you know, having to wait 42 minutes to speak to someone in the council tax department and things like that. So I don't know where they get that 88% satisfaction level from. It clearly does not represent the real, you know, experience that I would say most people have on phoning the switchboard, the contact centre. And I just think people must complain if they get less than satisfactory service, hellish though it is.
If you don't get through, you don't get the opportunity to give a comment, do you?
No, you have to bump into the chair of the performance committee, you know, somewhere in the street, as I did, and give him an earful and tell him how bad it is, and then he says, "Yes, it is, isn't it?"
David,
I was looking at an advert in the Law Gazette, current one, about. Company, the obligation to do your due diligence so criminals don't catch you out. And I thought, I don't know what kind of scrutiny was done before the contract was entered into. And I'm thinking, has anyone seen the members register? Do any of our Tory councillors or any councillors appear in the members register?
Good question.
Is there not a history of dodgy contracts, like claiming for services like putting bracelets on people who've died to monitor their movements or something, or whatever, or exceeding the number of people that they're actually officially supposed to be dealt with? I know it's not directly on the carrying out of the current contract. But I just wondered what kind of due diligence had been undertaken before the contract was entered into.
Well, declared interests are available on the website for anybody.
Are there any names that people have noted?
I'm not aware of anybody who's declared an interest in Capita.
The problem is you don't have to. It's at the second part where you could declare if you're a shareholder. You don't. It's voluntary. And I think almost no councillor, no Tory councillor, has filled that in voluntarily. So you wouldn't know if any member of the council did have shares in Capita.
Yeah, so they could have shares, but not a very significant shareholding that would influence the company itself. I think that there is a threshold, isn't there, I believe, about declarations. I mean, I'm not aware of any evidence of that nature. If anybody has any such evidence, I'd be very interested in it. Right, shall we invite Keith Nason to address us now as a...
Right.
NUT officer? NUT officer?
NUT local secretary. I'm also a teacher at the Pavilion Study Centre, if you know the Pavilion. Right, my comments about Capita are going to be as a user of the services through being a teacher. One thing as well, and having, when we were dealing with the move out of North London Business Park, it did amaze me, and I don't know if it got mentioned, that somehow Capita miscalculated by about 300 people, which is why originally the plan was to move completely out of Building 4, but part of it is actually retained, and that is used purely by Capita. People like HR are there, I can't remember what other services they've got, but I'm not sure how they miscalculated that. Something I have noticed just being at Barnet House, there's custodians, one, at least one who's been an agency worker there for nearly 2 years. And what concerns me is he's a fire warden. Now, if you have an agency worker, that worker can decide the next day, no, I don't want to work there anymore. You might get another job and go. Yet he's on the list of fire wardens. At least if you've got employees doing it, then you know, they should be giving notice. I suppose there's a possibility they could be ill or, you know, something more serious, and they're not available. But the fact of relying on an agency worker to be a fire warden does seem a bit of a concern. The main service that I experience is HR. Now, you may not be aware, but schools even community schools, in other words, ones where London Borough of Barnet is the employer, do not have to use Barnet's HR or now Capita's HR. So even before that, before it was outsourced, some schools were going elsewhere for their HR service. And in fact, the changes they made ready for outsourcing weren't popular, which was to move away from a named person for the school for the routine dealing with HR. Because generally, I personally like it if I know who I'm speaking to and I get the same person. But obviously, economies of scale, and to prepare to move the bulk of the HR service to either Belfast or Carlisle. I can't remember where the local government pension scheme is. I think it might be Darlington. So that was one of the things that they'd already started to cause a bit of a problem. But what the idea was, Capita were going to make lots of money by getting back those schools that didn't buy Barnet HR. If you look at the list, and unfortunately I haven't had a chance to get you some data, but certainly a number of schools moving away, talking about moving away. Even Mott MacDonald, who are taking over education skills in just under a month's time, are actually going to use Islington HR, not Capita. It might be just for payroll, but certainly I think, and then they'll use their own HR service. So that, anyway, is one of the problems. They actually realised that they couldn't get rid of all the service in Barnet, because there was actually some very good bits that were keeping schools, and that was sometimes the only reason schools were buying Barnet HR, was something called employee relations, which sort of deal with the sort of less run-of-the-mill things, and that's usually the things that I engage with as a union rep when I'm representing people. And they've got some very experienced people there, over 20 years service, knew schools well, were very good at their job. And they realised they actually needed to keep those people, because otherwise they actually would lose all the schools. In fact, what I hear they're doing now is they are actually going to offer that as a separate service, just to try and retain some schools that want to go elsewhere, say for payroll and routine HR. But it's also costing schools more money, because on top of what they're paying, they're now expected to do a lot more of the work, because instead of them sort of sending stuff to people at Barnet who would process it, they now have to have office staff processing it, so that's adding to the workload, so they're getting less for their money, even if it's at the same price. And my understanding, I don't have any figures, but I get schools telling me that actually they go cheaper than Barnet, but they went there because of the retained there because of the ER service. Another area where it's now costing schools money, but it's good for Harrow. We've heard about HB Public Law. If a school wants to enter into a settlement agreement with a member of staff, and if you don't know what a settlement agreement is, it's where there's an agreement for somebody to terminate their employment, usually there's a sum of money involved, and there's a contract called a settlement agreement. Now, it used to be, when Barnet did it, that their legal services produced it, and it was all part of buying Barnet HR, and we'd liaise with the ER people, and the document would come out. And when one of the people that used to produce the documents left, she then went and worked for the NUT for a while, and actually was then had to check that it was all right to give legal advice on her own documents, but that's another story. But what it now means is that even if they buy Capita HR, and perhaps as Capita HR has negotiated a settlement with a member of staff, Capita HR, these very good people, so unfortunately we're not allowed to do the settlement agreement. You have to go off on your own. Now, they normally recommend HB Public Law, who then charge the schools for that, whereas before they would have got that agreement included in the price. And so then they do something, and then the member says, well, I don't like that. And presumably there's a meter running in Harrow, and that just clicks up some more money. I don't know how much it costs schools, but it is costing them more. I know one head teacher was getting rather frantic with me because my member was actually, you know, raising some issues and was a bit difficult. And it was costing him money, I think, each time he rang up HB Public Law. So we've got that. Trying to deal with some resolutions as a teacher, I've got a pension with the teacher pension scheme. Now, I'm one of the people who found my record was wrong. To be fair, it was actually not caused by Capita, it was done by Barnet. But it took me a long while to even have a way that teachers could resolve their teacher pensions. And one of the problems was Capita had, Barnet Capita, had trouble talking to teacher pensions and couldn't find somebody. Now, there was a company that runs that, the teacher pension, the National Teacher Pension Company called Capita, that's the one. Okay, so there was a bit of problem with communication between the two bits of Capita. And still, the number of times I come across problems, I have now got a number to contact. But similarly, members of staff used to be able to just go and ring up Barnet with a query about the... No, you have to go to your school office, and because you need a PIN to be allowed to talk to Capita, because mere teachers mustn't sully those people by talking, you know. They've got to talk with somebody more important than a mere teacher or a mere teaching assistant or a caretaker who might have a problem with their pay. So that's more work for the office staff that were already overworked when it used to be quite easy. And when we had payroll in Barnet, it was quite easy. If I had a problem, the simplest thing for me to do, I used to have an office at North London Business Park, I'd walk upstairs, say, we've got a problem here, can we get this sorted? And usually it was. It's very difficult for me now to resolve it through Capita. So what we're seeing is, what I see, is a worse service, costing schools more money and making it harder and creating more work. And I suppose maybe I should look at being a shareholder in one of the competitors. Although one thing that I've noticed, one of the competitors has enlarged so much the quality of their services deteriorated because they've taken on so much work quite quickly. So I'm not sure where we've seen the benefit. I certainly don't know if there have or haven't been any financial benefits, but I can't see that it's necessarily been good for schools. I think that's it.
Thank you very much. Now, same format, I'll throw it open to questions.
Could I just jump in there very quickly, because it did make me laugh, because I'm now involved with Capita in this wrangle about, it's connected with my pension. I teach in Barnet and have done for many years, about to retire. I'm trying to sort out things, and it's almost impossible. I've been going round and round in circles. It's just horrendous.
I'm going to ask, are you one of my members then, if you're a teacher in Barnet?
I'm not in the NUT.
All right. Okay, that's the same page.
And I'm hoping I might get some help from them, because it really, as I say,
which is
NASUWT.
Right, okay.
But I might ask you for the number you mentioned, if that's all right.
But I'd have to dig it, yeah.
But my question
is... Well, Nargis can provide that then. Well,
there are so many problems, and we've heard so many of them, but what do we do? Which is why I came here this evening, really, to find out what on earth do we do? Because...
Well, for schools, I'm talking about schools, and one of the options they've got is they're now going elsewhere. When the idea was that Capita, one of the ways that they would make savings is because they would grow and take more business. Now, I believe, unfortunately I can't prove it because I haven't got those figures, but I believe they've actually lost more schools than they've gained. They are getting a few back sometimes, but they're certainly losing them as well.
So one of the solutions is to sort of inform schools that, you know, who do not have to be tied into Capita.
I think schools know that, well enough, and that's why they're going elsewhere, and I suspect their competitors out there are also then, ready to take on and mostly publicising themselves. I don't know how they gain their business, but that is one of the issues. And it's an issue, you know, I don't know how many of you are school governors, but obviously that might be an issue for you if you're school governors who you use. It would be a shame because, as I said, Barnet's, you know, the Capita HR, there are some really good people who were with Barnet and they're very good. I'm glad they're around, because when I'm trying to support my members, they're excellent. And I'm really glad that Capita did hold on to those. I believe originally the plan was to get rid of those people as well, so that there wouldn't have been that support for schools. And that's the one thing that I think does keep the business.
I do have to say, when you use the PIN and you get through to a human, he or she is usually very helpful as far as they can be.
Yes, I think one of the problems as well is they don't always know things about Barnet. The teachers, there's two different sick pay schemes. For some reason, I can't find out when it was introduced, there's actually a different sick pay scheme. And they then need to know that, because it actually, if somebody's off sick for more than 100 days as a teacher, and unfortunately with the stresses, that's happening more often, it affects their pay.
To answer the question, what do you do if you've got a problem with Capita? I mean, in your case, obviously you go through your trade union. But you know, if you feel it's appropriate, councillors are supposed to take up cases. The contact details for Labour councillors are on the website, and we publicise them through various means, including leaflets through the door, for instance. I mean, it's up to you which councillor you go to. If you have a Labour councillor where you live, that's great. But we do take up casework from people who don't live in our wards. It's up to you. But sometimes the councillor taking an interest and asking for a report on the case does cause resolution.
Thank you for that. That's
I think seriously, anyway, taking it seriously.
I don't know how that happens for people, teachers like me, that don't live in Barnet, but...
Well, if it's employment within Barnet, it's competent business for Barnet councillors, I feel.
And also, one of the problems it sometimes causes, if there's an error made by Capita, because they are contractors to the school, it's actually explained to member staff, you know, your dispute is with your school, it's not with Capita, because Capita is providing a service, say it's providing payroll. If they muck up the payroll, then that is a dispute with the governing body of the school, or possibly the London Borough of Barnet if it's a community school. And if there's any costs, the school have to bear that, and then they would have to sue Capita separately for those costs. The member of staff wouldn't sue Capita directly, is my understanding.
Ross?
Yeah, thanks, Keith. As you know, I'm the chair of governors of a school in Finchley, and a primary school. And one of the things I've definitely had fed back is that the head and the office manager are spending several days a month on HR related issues. In other words, doing a lot of work that previously had been done by Barnet HR, and actually making sure all the information's there, stuff that they used to do on the school's behalf, I think. Some of it's double checking, but a lot of it is actually also providing information that they didn't have to do because of Barnet HR did. And that obviously that has a knock-on effect in terms of, you know, that has a cost to it.
That's what I was going to say.
And an office manager, there is a hidden cost in a way of
or a teacher. That's an expensive way of doing it.
It's an expensive way, yeah. So would you say that's that similar things have happened in other schools?
Or definitely. This is what I'm hearing when I go around the complaint. But the other problem is, because they're not experts at doing this, that the previous people that got made redundant might have been, and the people they'd ring up and just say, what do I do about this, and they'd do it, is it mostly takes them longer as well, because they're not HR people now, but they happen to do all these roles that previously would have been fulfilled by Barnet HR when they were based in North London Business Park.
Can you enlighten us about what proportion of HR staff are at North London Business Park and what proportion are elsewhere, like Belfast?
Right. Well, the bulk of the staff have gone on. One thing I'm confused about is there is actually a Barnet HR person now. I don't understand why we've suddenly got one. When I say a Barnet HR, that's in addition to the Capita contract. They've employed somebody. But there's only a handful of people who deal with HR at Barnet. Most of, I don't know, because I believe that both at Carlisle and Belfast, the people don't solely deal with the Barnet contract. And so therefore, to say the numbers, and I'm not too aware, some Unison or GMB would mostly have a better idea, because it would be their members that were made redundant. They'd know how many went and how many stayed. And most of my work, actually, HR-wise, was with the ER people that remained.
We were told, because we specifically asked, that it was things like payroll that
that has been sent to Belfast, but the people dealing with the personnel issues were still based in Barnet.
The people who deal with sort of specific, perhaps somebody who's got attendance management, something like that, they would be supported then by person at Barnet.
Yeah.
So those people remain. HR, and I was never clear about it, interestingly, in other ways. There's payroll, and then there was sort of routine HR work as well, and all that has moved. So it's not just payroll, but it was actually the routine HR has gone to Belfast for non-school staff and Carlisle for school staff, and I said Darlington for local government pension scheme. I'm not quite sure what happens about teacher pensions. One of the problems with teacher pensions was there used to be a really good woman who worked for Barnet, and she left a few months before the contract started, and of course they wanted to save money on redundancies, so they didn't replace her, and it meant it was just being added to other people's work. And I remember I was going up to people, one person in particular who'd been lumbered with this. He didn't really have a clue about that, that's fair to say a clue, but he certainly wasn't as experienced on teacher pension issues. I mean, I'd have to go up to him, and I think he was mostly putting it to one side in the too difficult to deal with, because I've got loads of other work that I can get through, and this one I couldn't cope with.
Yeah. Were these shortfalls in HR function part of the contract, or has this been fiddled by Capita to increase their profits? In other words, is there no redress from Capita for functions which need to be paid for in extra time, etc.?
Unfortunately,
or was it in the an error at the time of the contract on the part of the council that didn't foresee this?
Unfortunately, I don't know that, because not being in a position where I was dealing with the contract, I'm only seeing it from the side of somebody trying to deal with the aftermath.
Well, has nobody asked Capita to explain that?
I think, I mean, this would be, again, I don't know if we've got any school governors here who are on governing bodies, because they're the people who are mostly going to be bothered, because one, their head teacher's wasting loads of time doing stuff which, you know, if you look at head teacher's time, that's a very expensive way of dealing with it.
Well, perhaps you can make a claim to Capita to meet these costs.
And what they're doing then, now I don't know if the other HR providers, but they're looking at, right, well, why do we stay with Capita? Why don't we go to, say, EPM or one of the other providers?
I doubt there's anything in the contract to say how many staff Capita have to employ in any particular area. It'll all be down to providing a service to a specified level, and whether or not they do that is contract management, which, as I said earlier, is about officers looking after it in what is called the commissioning group of officers who have been retained by Barnet. Originally, they had a very weak commissioning group, and the model that they employed was called the thin client model, where they retained very little expertise in Barnet to determine whether or not their contractors were doing what they were supposed to do. They did eventually agree, Barnet administration, that they needed to beef up that commissioning group, and there are a number of people in quite senior positions who have been added to the team. But as I said earlier, the committee that is supposed to be overseeing all of this doesn't see the outcome of this to any significant extent. It hasn't so far, and so we need to keep pressing for that to happen.
Can I make one other? I don't know if it would end up being an additional cost, but you spoke about commissioning. One of the things that happened is, I mentioned Mott MacDonald taking over education and skills from the 1st of April. Well, when that originally went out to tender, and it had more than one bidder, it ended up with one bidder, which didn't seem a good way of tendering something, but anyway. One of the bidders was Capita. So therefore, Capita couldn't provide the HR service, so they had to bring in additional HR service. Now, I don't know who paid for that, whether Capita had to pay for that out of the contract, or whether it was just additional cost for the council to be able to outsource education and skills. But that did involve bringing in consultants, right, which I'm sure John will know prices that they were paid.
But one thing I was going to say is, I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, but HR has been identified as a failing service. Service credits have been applied, and they have had to put in an improvement plan to resolve the problems with HR. So it is identified as a problem, and they are being penalised for not delivering to the contract.
Yeah, HR is one of the weaker parts of the contract, certainly.
I just thought that we should perhaps, because of the uncertainties, as to what exactly is going wrong and who was technically responsible at an extra cost or reduction in their work output, whether we should be more aggressive. When in doubt, always bump them with a bill. Put the burden, the onus on them to demonstrate that they have no obligation or responsibility for what's been amiss.
I think with schools, and remember there is a lot more of HR, I'm only as a teacher, most of my dealings is the school side, which is a, what's called a traded service. So there is actually a contract that schools enter into separately with Capita to provide that service. Now, I'm not sure what it says they will provide. I think it's mostly saying they don't provide the service that Barnet used to, it's just not available. And I don't think the competitors provide it either, though, to be fair. And so, therefore, schools, when they're paying in or buying a service, they know, you know, their terms and conditions will say it doesn't provide that. They've got to do it through online services now, which they didn't used to have to do.
Well, I don't know whether what you're saying in effect is it's, the issue is divided between so many parties and schools that it's not practical to pull this together. I don't know whether that's a union function to take an oversight and a strategy to redress and challenge.
It's not really, because it's not our members, it's a service for schools, not for our members, and therefore it's up to governors of schools. One of the things we don't really have in Barnet, as far as I see, is a strong overall, almost a union for governors.
Governors for them, yeah.
You know, it's something I think we really need, because it's quite often, sorry, I'm dying. Aggressive a bit, but I think it's something schools need, because when they need to get elect a governor to represent a type of school, say on schools forum, I don't think there's any real formal way of doing that, and it's almost just if there's a vacancy for say a VA governor, it's almost that they go and try and find one. I don't think there's an election as such, but I might be wrong.
Any more?
I was just going to back up what Keith was saying, really. I think it sounds very simplistic. When you set up this contract, it sounds so, oh yes, it's cheaper to do it that way. But in fact, in the long run, it isn't cheaper. And it's very, very difficult to quantify, quantify, say, A, B, C, and D looks cheaper to deliver this way, or out from Pershore than it from Barnet. But actually, it comes down to, in the end, it comes down to a quality of service, and it's very difficult to provide that when you've got a tight contract that just says you have to do A, B, and C. I mean, it's, for example, I've heard of schools ringing, used to be able to ring up Barnet, and the officers in Barnet knew all the schools. They knew what was going on, they knew what would have to happen if there was like building work at the school or something like that. They knew exactly. Nobody knows that anymore, because those staff, they're there. It's not actually cheaper in the long run. It costs more, as we've been hearing
from
various, I think.
Right, okay, well, thanks, okay. Keith, and thanks. Thanks to John. These are the two sort of build speakers, but I will be opening up to anybody else who wishes to make a contribution. Phil?
Just a more general question to John about when the council, the current Tory administration, claims that they have saved so much X figure, and they, I can't remember what it is, but they're probably in the budget papers this week. Is it clear what they are measuring that against? I mean, no. You talked about all these extra payments and the variations in contract. Can we actually, is it clear when that they've saved this amount against what was going to be spent, and where the savings are? Because that is the main That is the main justification for having Capita, is saving the tax, this lot of waste and lot of money.
I have asked for that evidence repeatedly. I've offered Richard Cornelius £250 to the charity of his choice so he can show me where the savings are being made. I have not seen any evidence as yet set out in a clear format as to where the savings are being made. There are savings on the core contract, I've always said that, but that's a false picture because it ignores all the additional costs that you pay on top. And that's where I feel we are ending up actually paying more. So it may be that they are claiming those savings on the core contract, but net, it's actually quite easy. If you go and look at the accounts that are published annually and look at what the spending is and say, has the spending gone down? No, it's actually gone up slightly. And have we had made cuts to the services? Yes. So where are the savings? And I cannot reconcile where those savings are being generated because they do not show in the annual accounts.
You've got to look at income as well.
You do.
Because the population's expanding,
yeah.
So they're getting more in.
Absolutely right.
That's quite
and they're generating more income.
Yeah.
Some of the additional contracts would have been had to be done by somebody else had they not been given to Capita. So it's trying to tease out whether we're getting a good deal on those additional contracts or whether we could have got them cheaper if we'd had in-house staff or somewhere else.
Because I think, as somebody was saying, it's now given to them on a plate as a right. So they have right of first refusal for all consultancy work.
Yeah.
And again, as you were saying, Jeff, it's about the number of days. They can say, well, it's 20 days. It might have only been three or four, but they can say, no, it's 20 days. As a personal experience, I'm dealing with a project at the minute with a charity in Barnet, and we have been dealing with, I think, five different project managers, and each one turns up to a meeting, and they're travelling from Blackburn, some of them, and then you get another one, and you have to brief them all over again, and you're thinking, hang on a minute, these people are billing Barnet. So there are some really big issues there, which I just don't think anybody on the Conservative side has ever addressed.
Thank you.
Another point we need to look at as Labour councillors dealing with this is the fact that all local government has had huge cuts in the money available to them, and they've had to make economies. And so it's not just a question of how Capita is doing in comparison with 3 years ago, it's also how they're doing in comparison with all the other councils who haven't outsourced to this extent and have been forced to become more efficient or stop doing things or whatever in order to deal with the budgets which national government has given them. So that's a comparison that we need to make as well.
Yeah. I thought I heard Councillor Finn talk about a figure something like £360 million being saved. Maybe I misheard. But anyway, and who knows what it's relating to. The other thing, you mentioned the money allocated from central government. I appreciate that it's dealt with by central government, but when I was involved with local government finance, we had something called direct support grant. We've now got revenue support grant. How I've never understood how it is they can calculate on the basis of every one of the 432 local authorities, apart from the city, who are obliged by law to state their resources, their reserves, the residents' needs, and their estimated coming annual expenditure. But the city is exempt all that. So how can they calculate equitably the money that should be going to the local authority, and on the basis of which Cornelius and others say, well, we've got 80 million short, so we've got to make up, we've got to cut the libraries and this, that and the other. A long time ago, there was a booklet published on the machinery of calculating the money that should go to each local authority. I've no doubt the city doesn't participate in that sense, but for instance, they never pay corporation tax because I think in 1067 they bunged William the First, a bung, and they kept their privileges ever since. So I just yet by contrast, when Ted Knight of Lambeth and the fellow in Liverpool delayed revealing their estimated annual expenditure, the whole of the press condemned them as loony left councils. You know, it seems to me so unfair that the city's still got the exception. And I know that Councillor John Marshall is a freeman of the city, and I wondered whether he'd got shares in, or a connection in shares in Capita. But anyway, I'm just saying that it seems to me that maybe the Labour Party could publish, I mean, it's a cyclical system of calculation. I think it used to take 3 years, and you use estimated populations, and then you had mid-term populations, and you tried to do it fairly, tried to divvy it all up fairly. But I can't understand with the non-information or the secrecy of the city how they could calculate it. That's all I could say.
Well, you're talking about national policy, not something that we can influence in Barnet. Certainly Richard Cornelius, the leader of the council, is always complaining that Barnet is hard done by.
Yeah.
and the national government aspiration is to stop the grant from national government entirely, and local government will be dependent on business rates and council tax within a few years. As Cornelius was saying only yesterday in the budget debate, that the City of London and Westminster get huge amounts of business rates, and there have to be some kind of redistribution there. But the formula that decides which councils get what is always controversial, and council leaders complain about it all the time, not least Barnet. There's huge debates about whether the Shire counties get more than their share, and when there's a Labour government, the urban authorities possibly do a bit better, but you know, obviously that's not been the case for a while. So yeah, I mean, what you say is noted, but I think it's outside the scope of this debate.
It's the baseline.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The reason the Tories say we've got to cut, and some Labour say you've got to cut, is because they're getting less from central government.
Yeah, but the bottom line for local government is that you have to set a balanced budget within the resources available. If you don't do that, then national government sends in commissioners to run the council for you.
Yeah.
And you know, there was some of that in the past, but I don't think any council is even contemplating doing it now.
When did that last happen?
When did it last happen?
Yeah.
1920s?
No, recent.
There was a case in Wales in Anglesey, wasn't there, where politically there was a lot of independents who kept changing their allegiance, and it all fell apart, and the Welsh government sent in commissioners to run the show. That's the last one I remember. But in effect, refusal to set a balanced budget is illegal.
Yes.
Triggers intervention by councillors. The only outcome of that is that elected representatives get sidelined and somebody else comes in to run it.
Bringing the discussion back to Capita, which I understand what is. So two things. First of all, something for you, for the panel, for the scrutiny committee to check is to do with the obligation to be tied in with Capita. If I remember correctly, your choice Barnet services were obliged to buy IT services from Capita. John nods, so I must remember it correctly. I'm not sure what happened with it, but I think Barry and the beginning of the consultation in your choice Barnet, and the changes that they did, this was the case, that the services, the day services, were obliged to purchase the IT services from Capita and could not opt out and purchase them elsewhere, like Keith say that school does. So I suggest this is something you might want to look into. The second thing is really to ask, and I apologize if you spoke about the beginning because I was a few minutes late, What's the plan for this scrutiny committee? I mean, is this first of a series of meeting? Are you going to take more evidence? How are you advertising it? And mainly, what is your plan? What are you going to do with it towards this exit point that I understand we now have from the contract? I mean, are you planning to do something with all the evidence you will gather to help us, as in Barnet residents, out of this contract?
Right, let's deal with the first point. I think that was the contract between the council and the Barnet group, and maybe Ross can enlighten us on that. But if there's a contractual obligation to use IT services from Capita, that will be in that contract.
My understanding, I don't think 100% is that yes, it's part of the council family, Barnet Group does do central services, so legal and HR, and that's one of the obligations. Because actually, you know, it's part of the, by the council, so it's part of them. So I think those sort of arrangements are tied into.
Yeah,
it is different for schools. Even community schools are
part of the because Barnet Group is owned by the council, whereas schools have separate governance arrangements, so they can, you know, they.
Actually, LMS of schools from the 80s.
In brackets, I would like to say that officially, your choice Barnet is not part of Barnet. It's an independent entity.
It's owned by the council. That's the difference between that and schools.
The Barnet group, which runs your choice Barnet, it's wholly owned by Barnet Council, but there's an agreement between the two parties, as I understand it. It's a contractual agreement.
Does include buying central services.
There's a question, actually, people might know about the contract. I just wondered, one of the things, the contract provides services for Barnet Council, but as the council is diminishing in size what it runs itself, does the Capita contract allow for that? For example, having fewer of its own employees, maybe fewer people using their own IT systems, things like that. Was the contract written in a way to cater for that?
Allegedly, there is flexibility. It's a 10-year contract, and so there needs to be flexibility in there. And you know, one of the areas of flexibility is reduced resources, obviously. I couldn't swear to you that the flexibility is sufficient to safeguard Barnet Council's interests against Capita's interests, but certainly that was the story that we as councillors were given. It must be an ongoing thing. Contract variations, as has been mentioned. I mean, if Barnet's got less money to spend because it's getting less from national government, then that has to be reflected in what can be bought with external contractors, including Capita. On the point about what are we doing, where is this information going? This is an evidence gathering session. If there is sufficient demand, then there could could be another evidence gathering session. There are some people who have sent apologies tonight because they were not able to go. So I'm sure that Gabby will be in contact with those people. If we decide that there is sufficient demand for another session, then of course we will set it up, and we have a distribution list of people who are told about it, and we tell the press and so on, and so you will hear. What happens to the information? Well, it's being recorded, it will be transcribed. We will produce some kind of a report similar to what we did with the Housing Commission, and the working party, which the council has set up, has five members, two of them from Labour, Cathy Levine and myself, and we will be feeding into that working party messages that are coming from this evidence gathering session. And that working party in turn will report to the full performance and contract management committee, and the timescale of that is a few months. I think the contract started at 1st of September 2013. It's a year three review, so the review will be around the autumn, and in principle Barnet could extricate itself from the contract, but don't hold your breath on that one. First of all, the Tories have the majority and will be making the decision. Secondly, even if there was a Labour majority at that point or some subsequent time, it could be a very expensive thing to do. And Labour councils, which have inherited contracts with contractors, have found it difficult to extricate themselves. If there's a clear failure against the targets within the contract, which could stand up in a court of law, because it might well be challenged, then the council could extricate itself before the full 10 years happens. I doubt that there is a legal case for doing that now, even if we had a Labour majority, because it would have to be something pretty substantial.
Councils
sometimes do that and sometimes get away with it, yes.
Very good article in the Guardian today.
Councils, Cumbria, and Associated Services.
Can you actually rate yourself, is it all or nothing?
That's an interesting point. I mean, you could sort of negotiate with your contractor and say this bit's good and that one isn't. We'll get rid of the whole lot unless you give us a deal on this smaller point.
In lots of cases, I mean, Birmingham did that, didn't they? They've been negotiating better terms and so on.
Can I just say,
ended up in the High Court with BT, didn't they? And got a judgment saying, no, you're quite right. They're not actually, you know, meeting the contract, so that's it. It's
over. So a lot of money for lawyers, yes.
Well, can I just say, it'll save more in the long run.
Yeah, definitely.
Complimentary to this review of Capita, we've initiated our own working party for the Labour group, and the remit of that is to look at the experience of other councils, both Labour and Tory, that have brought services back in-house. And there's quite a bit, the union's done quite a lot of research. There's a long list of councils in the last two or three years that have brought and the piece in the Guardian, I think, is similar, on various grounds, cost, quality, you know, efficiency, where they have actually proved to be more expensive than they're worth. And they've been able to bring things back in house. So we want to look at examples, gather feedback from that, and then inform our policy as we go forward to the next local elections, so that we can actually, in answer to Terza's point, that is the basic point to feed in, so that whether or not we can terminate the Capita contract because of legal issues, we have a credible policy on outsourcing and building up in-house bids for services as we go forward. So, and the Capita review feeds into that. So it's kind of two parallel streams.
OK.
Keith?
I was just going to wonder if you're going to have a strategy as well so that you could look at bringing it back in-house, because one of the problems that the Tories have done is to sort of take the services away, reduce the office space, lost that expertise. So if they were, say HR, what I mentioned, was to, and payroll was to be brought back, is you would have to get, you know, what's the strategy to get that expertise back, or how are you going to acquire that expertise, as well as the space to put the people to do that?
Yeah, huge practical issues. The council is intending to move its offices to Graham Park from North London Business Park, and obviously the floor space will be adequate for the number of retained staff rather than the number that they used to have. So if it was to be brought back in-house, then there would need to be a significant amount of office space in addition, and it probably wouldn't be available in Graham Park, so you'd be looking to acquire lease probably office space somewhere else in the area. But as Keith says, the expertise is gone. Most of the people who did this stuff for Barnet 3+ years ago are no longer working for Barnet, they've gone off elsewhere. Therefore, the option just to bring them back in house as a sort of a two-pie operation is not straightforward, because they're scattered all over the country, as we've heard. They're in Blackburn, Carlisle, Coventry, Belfast, wherever. Capita's operation is very fragmented, which is one of the issues, I think. And so there are practical barriers to bringing it back in-house. That's not to say we won't look at it as a Labour group, but it ain't easy. It's much harder to bring it back in, I think, given the way in which Capita is running the show from centres all around the country.
Sort of directly in relation to that then, have you been briefed at all about this Project Chicago thing, which seems to be a centralised management, which presumably will have a huge impact on the way the contract's delivered? It'd be even more fragmented, won't it? Or at least it'll be more removed from Barnet, it'll be more centralised. So, to what extent have you been informed about it at all as members? But well, in which case, should you not be pressing for it? And, I mean, obviously the Tories didn't know what it was either. But
I think to what extent they're making their service more efficient by sharing what Barnet's doing with what they're doing for Barnet with what they're doing for other councils. So instead of having a group that does Barnet, they say
it's more efficient, but that's questionable, isn't it? I mean, if they can't manage it.
They're doing it to make more money, so yeah, it will be more efficient.
For them, more efficient for them.
It's not necessarily going to give you the same quality of service, but they're not doing it because it's going to cost them more. They're doing it because it's going to save them money.
Can we explain for people who don't know what Chicago is?
It's a place in America.
Okay. Capita has an internal project called Project Chicago, where they are looking at how they can share resources between customers. So Barnet and all the other people they have, in order to achieve efficiencies for them. So it's all about their bottom line, right? And I was surprised that they needed to do that, to be honest, because it was sold to us 3-4 years ago that this was one of the big selling points of Capita, that they had this expertise already doing this stuff for all these other customers, and that we Barnet would get the benefit of it. So now they are looking to do this even more than they were already. It appears that mostly we have had dedicated staff working for Barnet. And it's
I and other councillors had a trip to Coventry to see what they are doing with the people who answer telephones and deal with members' inquiries and so forth. And there's a big building, and there's a sort of flag on a desk, and you know the people around here are working for Barnet, and there's several other local authorities all in the same large open plan office. So they've already got people doing similar things for similar types of clients, but apparently it's from their point of view, it's they're in silos. By the looks of it, they're not interacting with each other, and they're not getting the benefit. Now, what we were told was that the sort of managerial expertise would be to our benefit, and they could put people across. To give us the benefit of what they had learnt dealing with other councils.
In which case, why have they not informed the councillors? And why are the councillors not kicking up and saying, you know, this is something you should be consulting with us since last year, because you've known about it since last year. I mean, I can't believe the Tories just sit there and find out about this thing a few weeks ago. And presume, have they asked any questions about it?
Well, we don't know what's going on behind the scenes. Certainly it's not been reported to committee, and if there are practical implications for Barnet in the way in which the services are delivered, then yes, we ought to be told about it. That, I think, will be, if not a formal contract variation, it's a significant change to the way in which they are delivering the contract, and so the committee ought to be informed. As I said earlier, it's a contract management issue, and we're not getting much information of that nature.
I think there's a subtle difference in that my understanding is Chicago is about RE much more than CSG.
Right.
And RE, because it's a JV, not a contract, is much more locally based. And my understanding is one of the issues is that Barnet are competing for work against other councils where Capita have contracts, and that actually they don't want councils to be competing against one another where they have an interest. Now, if this were a straight contract, you could understand the benefits. The issue is, this is a JV. So actually, what may benefit Capita may financially disadvantage Barnet.
Yes,
and actually it creates, I think, quite major legal issues as to the nature of the JV. So that's why I think actually it's a really big issue, but it has much more legal impact on RE.
What's JV?
Joint venture.
Okay, just as background, the highways, the planning, the building control, all that stuff is in a joint venture which is jointly owned by Capita and Barnet Council, and RE stands for Regional Enterprise. Yes, and the idea was that in addition to doing work for Barnet, they would tender for work of the same nature for other authorities, and Barnet would get the benefit of that as a joint owner. I'm not aware of anything of that nature. I'm not even sure it will come to performance and contract management committee. It might come elsewhere, to policy resources, for instance. It's a good question. So, you know, if it's about Capita not competing with itself, then yes, that could be very interesting. If it is only about RE, and doesn't impact on the customer and support group contract, then again, I think we as councillors need to be informed. And you know, Theresa Musgrove brought it up as a question as a member of the public at a recent meeting, and I for one didn't have any prior knowledge of it, so
I wanted to trick Finn into admitting he didn't know what it was about before he realised he was admitting he didn't know what it was about. You see what I mean? Which is extraordinary, because they, you know, it seems to me senior management are becoming more and more secretive and withholding information that actually you as elected members must and should have.
If it's going on inside RE, then Barnet ought certainly officer level ought to know about it, because it's a joint venture.
Yeah.
In practice, Capita calls the shots in Re.
This is a total inversion of democracy. I mean, you are the bosses,
meetings,
and they
answer.
Actually, I know, I'm just saying. Yeah. And that is outrageous what they're doing, I think.
Any Tories actually working for Capita? I don't know.
Okay, yes. We have a list of people who responded to an invitation, and there's quite a few here. Does anybody wish to make a presentation from the floor? Okay, well, not obligatory.
I think Keith made a good point in terms of the expertise. I think we need to build up our expertise about, and the unions have done some work on this, about preparing in-house bids to run, it's not just Capita, but to run various services, and we can learn from other councils that have done that, because we probably, for instance, the education contract, obviously the Tories wouldn't allow an in-house bid, but that doesn't mean, say, we shouldn't be doing the work to have services ready to take on, to take over service, to take on services in-house, as opposed to contracting them out, so that the work needs to be done. And a lot of other councils have done this, built up their expertise, and they can actually show that their own direct services are saving money and more cost effective than the private contractor, which is why a lot of them have been brought, services have been brought back. But obviously, and there's also they're tending to put services over to the Barnet Group now as one alternative between in-house and contracting out. So that's something else.
I would have thought that if Capita are not failing in one part of the contract, there's no point in you saying you can do it cheaper, because that bit of the contract's not up for grabs.
Well, the thing is hidden in, the issue is to try to show that things are, they're saving money, or that things can be done cheaper, and that's part of this process. It's John saying, it's showing how difficult it is.
But I would have thought that the very fact that you say that you can do something cheaper,
it's
not a reason for you getting it back.
I didn't say cheaper. It's talking about quality.
Okay,
and about
for quality. But
The various reasons why councils have brought services back. Sometimes it's cost, sometimes it's quality. There are different criteria.
So a question then: If Capita are not failing in some part of their contract, do you have a ground for getting it back? If they're not failing.
There is a contract clause, and the cost of exiting the contract is documented, it's minuted. It was one of the legacy things from dear old Craig Cooper, who actually spelt out that there is an exit option and what the costs of that exit option are from the CSD contract. The issue would be, it keeps coming back to, the way the contract was set up, it was set up so that it can never be brought back in-house. Yeah. And that is where the problem lies. Not only are all the people scattered hither and thither, all the data is on so many different computer systems. Mm. Actually just bringing that data back will be incredibly difficult.
Computer systems have all been moved.
That's right, yeah.
They're actually on Capita property.
Yeah. I think there's two issues here. If they were failing such that you could justify to a court that they weren't complying with their contractual obligations to a significant extent, then the Barnet could extricate itself from the contract, but it would be a monumental legal and practical issue, as has been said. When you get to near the end of the contract, 6-7 years time from now, deciding what to do next, then you can, whoever's in charge of the council at that time can decide what to do about it. They could, for instance, allow an in-house bid if there's any expertise left in-house to mount such a bid. And you can certainly have a competition between external parties. It wouldn't just be capital being extended. So this is not an immediate issue. I don't think we're at a point where we could extricate ourselves at reasonable cost for all the reasons that have been mentioned, the practical ones and the financial ones. So what we can do is attempt to hold Capita to their contractual obligations, and I have serious doubts whether that's happened over the last 3 years.
Plus, we're also looking to see whether we need any variations to the contract because of changing circumstances.
Yes. Yeah, that's right. As I said, there are changes. There are mechanisms in the contract for negotiating changes, and councillors need to have oversight of that, and not just the administration councillors.
Can I just ask, is there any part of the contract or any service that Capita's providing that you would say isn't failing?
Cleaning themselves.
Cleaning the windows.
From my perspective, I think it's very hard to say that the contract is failing, because from my perspective, I don't think it's failing. It's just not doing very well,
and
it's quite expensive. And I think that's the problem. If there was a catastrophic problem, then I think it would be dead easy, and you could say, right, termination. Here are the stuff. But actually, they're just average, and they were billed as being super efficient and delivering great quality.
Is there anything that they're doing well?
Well, residents' perception survey says that residents are more satisfied with the service.
How do they carry out that perception
survey? They do it with their own.
Sorry, but saying you said super efficient, but then people complaining. So how can they say that they're super efficient, and that's the main selling point when? They're failing the super efficiency point.
Who frames that perception survey? And I mean,
they've got a panel of selected people.
How do they select the?
It's random.
It's telephones. Yeah, it's done.
But
what's
interesting, because I've requested Rosie Evangelou, who provides me when I ask the raw data, and. There is a ton of raw data. It's about looking at the difference between users and non-users. And what you find quite often is people who never use the service say it's great. Mm. And they actually track that. So lots of people say, well, how's the cancer service great? Well, do you use it? No.
I think one area possibly they're doing okay, not brilliant, is council tax collection. They are collecting around the same percentage that the council used to do before it was outsourced, I think.
It's just fractionally below.
Right.
But don't they get extra payment?
So, and that was a good level. That was compared with other authorities, that was a good percentage. Yeah. So we can't say they're a huge failure. They might not be meeting their contractual obligations on that. We need to look at that. And it was very interesting that the last report we had on the committee, they gave it as an absolute amount of money collected rather than a percentage. And as has been said already, there's more people to pay. And so you'd expect them to collect more money.
John made about the data being everywhere. Does that mean that Capita's basically set up a contract which it would be very difficult even for another, at the end of the 10 years,
it would be a lot dearer
for another competitor to take it on? Yeah. So Capita almost guaranteed an indefinite contract.
Well, there would be an obligation on them to have an orderly transfer from one computer system to another. It would be a huge failure of contract drafting if that were not the case, and we are assured that it is the case.
What if they don't want to? The practicalities might be different. I mean, to be honest, Barnet had run the computer systems down prior to the contract starting, and so almost anything that Capita did would be an improvement. And they have now got all the computer systems on their own kit, so it might be relatively straightforward to go from one system to another. I think staff is a much bigger issue about an exit strategy, because the people with the expertise now are scattered all over the place.
There is this outfit called the European Services Strategy Unit, which did this report that was in The Guardian.
Yeah, that's Dexter Whitfield. It's probably worth asking them. He's been to Barnet and written reports, lots of reports. David, three things. I believe Saracens, the rugby people, deal with some of our road signage for Barnet. Is there any tie up between Saracens and Capita? I don't know. Secondly, why do the Tories not want to hold these kind of meetings, the contract review meetings in public, all in public, presumably they've got something to hide. And Councillor Finn spoke about, in moving his motion, he said that they were quite happy to hold meetings around the borough, but not what they call the private part. I don't know. What are the private parts? And the third thing is, today's issue of the Health Service Journal carries two pages on the sacking by Barnet Clinical Commissioning Group of a whistleblower dealing with the question of doctors attached to homes being paid twice. Now, that's a separate issue, but I just wonder whether anyone has got any answers to the question of the Saracens, and also why the Tories don't want to hold these meetings in public.
Saracens pay Barnets, don't they? A small amount for that, putting those...
But are they connected to Capita in
this,
some
this
contract?
This is pre-Capita.
Sorry?
This is before Capita.
I know it's before Capita.
I'm not aware of any linkage between Saracens and Capita. Okay. Again, if anybody knows to the contrary, I'd be very interested. The third thing you mentioned, something to do with the clinical commissioning group. I'm not sure whether there's any Capita aspect to that.
No, I don't think so.
The bit about the working group meetings and whether or not they are to be in private or in public, the Labour group acknowledges that there might be some commercially sensitive stuff about what about sums of money which they want to air in private. We've never denied that. The council has a well-established mechanism for having a public session and a private session, and the private committees and the private session have blue papers, and when there's
so
a discussion...
Why do the Tories not want that?
Well, let me finish. There's a well-established set-up. We did it yesterday at full council, for instance, about Red Cross Cricklewood development. It works fine. When the working group was set up, the Labour members on the Performance and Contract Management Committee moved that the meetings be in public, except for when there was commercial confidentiality. Our motion was defeated by the Conservative majority. Yes. We weren't given a reason other than that allegedly if it was in if it was in public, then councillors would not feel able to say what they thought about the contract.
We would play to the gallery.
Yes, and we would, you know, the bloggers would take it over or something like that.
So we
weren't satisfied with that. At full council, we moved again that the meetings be held in public, and again the Tories voted it down. When it came to the subsequent meeting of Performance and Contract Management, when I challenged it on the minutes, Councillor Finn, the chair of the relevant committee, said, well, actually, they decided that, after all, some of the sessions will be in public after all. We don't know the details. The devil might well be in the detail, but they have conceded the principle that some of the working group
sessions will be in public. We don't know how well it'll be publicised. We don't know whether the public will know what is on the agenda, won't know whether there's officer reports which will be available for reading before the meeting. We haven't got any dates for any of these working party meetings yet. We do know that they need to happen within the next few months because, as I said, September the 1st is the 3-year anniversary. So what's this space?
Can you demand that they will be made public, advertised on the council's calendar like any other meeting and so on,
well,
and agendas?
We can't demand it. We don't control the council. We can we can urge them to do so and do so. One of the issues is that the council has a constitution written which and approved by full council, which determines how things work. About how committees work, for instance, but working groups are not covered in the constitution, and so they are making up as they go along. We just don't know how it's going to happen.
Sorry, can I just, I'm absolutely on a huge learning curve here, let me admit that, but I'm sure that the majority of people from whatever political party believe that when things are done in secret, it's because things are being hidden. And if you take it to the extreme and say, should all councils operate everything in secrecy, who is going to agree with that? And I really do think the public need to be informed about what has happened so far so that it doesn't get any worse.
I agree with you entirely, and I think the Tories have come to the same conclusion belatedly, that politically they to be arguing for complete secrecy was not in their interest, and that's why they've done a U-turn.
Oh, well, a very, very partial one. We need to make sure that it's extended.
Well, yes.
We need to be careful about commercial sensitivity too.
Yeah.
What is going on with this commercial sensitivity that we can't be open about? What's going on? That's what people are starting to want to know.
See, the Birmingham leader is now Labour. And they are saying, if you don't want us to discuss the details of your contract, we don't want you as our contractor.
Exactly.
So they really turned the tables.
Mm. But
this council's not going to do it.
And he said they'd have it in public. They'd have the contract negotiations in public if they didn't.
Yeah.
If there's anything that people, ordinary people, can do to support your view that it needs to be open and above board, seem to be above board, that this kind of behaviour of secrecy, if there's anything that we
right
can do as part of, right to the press, but the press, is there any... we really do need
what,
to make
what
these...
What are you thinking of in terms of...
It's already been slightly suggested that there may be a possibility of perhaps travelling around the borough and taking this format, which is, a fantastic start, to other areas.
Yeah.
And it gives us time to think in between.
Yeah.
And really, it's a question of you can see that there is great interest and that the public are behind the Labour councillors.
Yes, I don't think there's been any commitment from the Conservatives to take evidence from the general public. I think, like I say, they're making it up as they go along. So publicly urging them to do that, to take evidence as we have tonight, and to have that discussion in public, and allow members of the public to speak to the councillors, that would be helpful. Lobby your local councillors of whatever political party. Watch for when the meetings are happening, those that you're allowed to go to, read the papers and complain if they're not made public in advance.
Look, it's more about the officers being clear and specific with all of our councillors. It's more about having things in secret so that there can't be people like our bloggers who are, well-meaning and expert people. We want them in the gallery. It's more about our people who we've elected being able to operate in honesty rather than us as public.
I think the format that was used by the Housing Commission, of taking evidence in different parts of the borough, taking evidence from experts, taking evidence from interested parties in housing tenants is something, you know, that is worth copying. And I think this is another example of trying to do things openly.
But it's also about keeping...
But
it's also about keeping councils healthy. And secrecy is not the way.
Absolutely.
I think that I would go along with that, because what the lady in the front is talking about is a matter of principle, not a question of whether we do these meetings all over the borough, which I think would be a good idea, don't get me wrong. Mm. So it's a question of principle. And the thing that springs to mind for me, naive as it might sound, is to go in conjunction with 38 Degrees to get a petition, a Barnet petition up, and getting people to write to bombard their local... My three councillors are Tory. If we can get people to bombard Tory councillors with this kind of, you know, request, it's not a demand, it's a request, if you like, to have the contract meetings out in, well, all council meetings really, in public. I don't know, does that do something?
Well, there's something really important.
Yeah,
if you wish to pursue that through 38 Degrees, that will be helpful, absolutely, yeah. Teresa?
Yeah, and just to add to Sylvia and Jenny, that we really need, I mean, we are fully behind you in trying to get out of this country, in scrutinizing it first of all and so on. But we need you to demand, you say you can't demand, you're not in control of the council, Jeff, but that is why you're in opposition, and we really need you to, you can still demand. Okay, you're not in control, you won't be able to make the decision, unfortunately, but you can demand as an opposition and know that the public is behind you and that we are all, and people, I don't know if you expected 20-something people, but I think if there will be more people, if there will be more meetings around the borough. And the other thing is, we don't expect really a lot of democracy from these Tories. They just cancelled the residence forums for the 30th of March. They cancelled it, and when I asked on behalf of Barnet Alliance, I was told it was done in agreement between the two parties. Now, why is it cancelled? Because it's before the elections. Is Gerda coming into it? It's residence forum. This is our opportunity to discuss things. I don't think PERDA should come into it.
It's not important.
I'm not an expert. But this is exactly an example where there could have been a greater democracy in this borough led by you as our opposition, which we would support you fully and do whatever we can to stand behind you.
You're talking about reviewing the contract in public. Then as I've already said, we, the Labour group on the committee, moved it at committee.
Yeah.
We, the full Labour group on council, moved it at full council. Both times we were voted down, both times in public, and we put out a press release about it as well. And ultimately, the Tories seem to have reconsidered. And so we have at least a partial success then.
Yeah.
As regards cancelling the residence forum, I don't know.
Perth starts on the 29th and
then
it's on the
30th.
Right. Well, I don't know.
I can't hear the back of your head, sister.
That Barry Rawlings is behind you.
Perth is about the run up to the local elections, mayor elections, and it happens to with general elections as well. You're supposed to not have.
Oh, Perth?
You're not supposed to. Civil servants are not supposed to. Be preparing
to make decisions,
papers
for
political parties. I think it's 6 weeks before the elections, which is probably covers the the area committees are carrying on, but the residents' forums.
They must have known about that for a long time.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
The area committees are carrying on.
I've told members of the public about it.
It's not a matter of cross-party discussion. It's to do with the law to do with elections.
Yes.
You know.
Barry, can you say anything about the cancellation of the residents' forums on the 30th?
It's Perda, isn't it?
It's Perda, yeah. Which is a period called the short campaign, 6 weeks.
Six weeks before the
days were known.
The days were known beforehand, so why now?
From 30th, and then and cancelled it, and not even as, or not arranging it for a week before, or not even as an alternative.
No, that was what I suggested. But well, it's forward a week.
Yeah.
But it's about getting papers produced and so on. The difficulty was that, as it was during the GLA campaign, there'd be nothing to stop all the candidates, and they would all turn up, and they all would make it, and it was felt that that would be unfair on officers who were running them, who were there to answer questions from candidates during the further period. If we were in control, and it's a GLA, we would expect the same. That's just a political convention that all the parties agree on. I think it should. I can see why you can't put it on the 30th. There's no reason to me why you can't put it on the
30th. Okay. Thanks for that, Barry. We're nearly at 9 o'clock. We need to vacate the room, I understand. David, I'm going to take you as your last contributor, please.
Yeah, just two things. When Mike Freer was a senior councillor in charge of finance, he consulted on the budget. I was one of the 8 people who turned up. He read the Times whilst I spoke for 2 minutes, and he said, well, I'm listening, aren't I? And 58 people sent in a letter, including organisations. Not much of a consultation. Subsequently, of course, we had 8,000 signatures against the contracting out on to Capita. Councillor Thomas dismissed it as a 2%, I don't know what. But I notice in the subsequent constitution, if we get 7,000 signatures, that matter has to go to full council. And I think if it's 2,000, it goes to the subcommittee. So there doesn't seem to be any logical rhyme or reason. But anyway, I've no doubt the councillors have got an eye on it.
Consultation by the Tories has been shown a number of times to be not of any great substance, and that's another example. Look, I'm going to wrap up the meeting now. Particular thanks to John Dix and to Keith Nason as our main speakers. That's been extremely helpful. Thank you to all of you for turning up and listening, and for the contributions that you've made from the floor. As I said, if there's demand from particularly from people who are unable to be here this evening, there may be another session. What's been said is on record and will be transcribed, and Cathy and I in particular will be feeding it in the main points into the working group's deliberations, which in turn will feed through to the main performance of contract management committee. Thanks very much for coming, and I hope you found it worthwhile.
And thank you to you guys as well.
Okay, hi guys. Hopefully you enjoyed that. That was 2 hours. That's probably, I don't know. But anyway, yes, this is OB from Occupy News Network. Peace out. I'll upload this to our YouTube after this one. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you. Bye. Okay, thanks. You can watch it.